Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Matthew 13 and beginning in verse 24. Bible said, another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the household came and said unto him, sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? And he said unto them, an enemy hath done this. The servants said unto him, wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Father, we ask your blessing upon your word. Thank you ever so much for it here today. And God, I pray that you would bless this congregation. I pray that you'd be with us, keep a watch over us, keep us healthy and encouraged. And I pray, most importantly, that we stay in love with you and serve you accordingly. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen. Someone has committed a dastardly deed against a man in this parable. A terrible thing. You have great expectations, and then someone comes along and spoils it. And the individual that did this, that someone is called his enemy. The adversary of all, according to verse 39, if you look ahead to the actual interpretation of the parable, where Jesus said, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. See, the devil is, he is a wicked commodity that is always doing something. He doesn't take a break. He doesn't take a rest. He doesn't take a vacation. He is always on the look. He's on the look for opportunity to disrupt, opportunity to destroy. And this was not accomplished without a plan, without a plan of attack. He's more focused than just willy-nilly, whatever happens to, he targets and he knows what he's doing and he knows who he's after and he knows what he wants to accomplish. Who is the enemy? See, that's the problem that we have as believers today. We don't know who the enemy is. We think that, one another, we're the enemy. The government, they're the enemy. The Chinese, they're the enemy. I mean, we're constantly pointing fingers in other directions to see who's at fault. The story is told in World War I, when that broke out, that the war ministry in London dispatched a coded message to one of the British outposts in an inaccessible area of Africa. The message read, war declared. Arrest all enemy aliens in your district. The war ministry received his prompt reply. Have arrested 10 Germans, 6 Belgians, 4 Frenchmen, 2 Italians, 3 Australians, and an American. Please advise immediately who we are at war with. We're just gathering up. We're hog-tying everybody that we think is an enemy. But you know what, folks? Paul, when he wrote to the Ephesians, pinpointed that the enemy is a little more dastardly than we think. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10 to 13, he said, finally, my brethren, he said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Again, he's a he's a character that's wily. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. He said to the Corinthians that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. But he says here that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, he said, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He said, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. You know, I was looking through the different verses in the Pauline epistles of all of his admonitions to the different groups, the different churches, to stand. Right now, folks, we're looking around, we're seeing people falling. They're falling left and right. They're not only falling by the wayside because of not having been where they ought to be, but they're falling for lies. They're falling for deceit. And they're falling for, well, they're about to take a fall. And we shouldn't allow it. It's time. It's time to take a stand. It's time to take a stand. And I'm not talking about standing up per se to the government. I'm talking about time to take a stand. We cannot allow our spiritual lives to falter at all. I mean, I mentioned recently in a message that this trial, you know, and Peter talked about that, the trying of your faith. He says it's more precious than gold that perisheth. And it ought to be, because what is gold being tried? What does it do? It purifies it. It makes it better. It makes it shine more. And how is that accomplished? Through fiery trials. And this, honestly, for most of us, as far as I know, it hasn't been all that fiery. Oh, it's been a test, it's been an inconvenience, it's been a lot of things. But we haven't been standing in soup lines. We haven't. Paul said to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 16:13, watch ye, he said, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong. He said to the Galatians, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free. He said to the Philippians, stand fast in one spirit, in Philippians 1:27. Again, he says in Philippians 4:1, stand fast in the Lord. He said to the Thessalonians, in 1 Thessalonians 3:4, and now we live if ye stand fast in the Lord. 2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 15, therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. And I want to preach a message that I just simply titled, it's time to stand. It's time to stand. 2 Corinthians 2 and verse 11 says, lest Satan should get an advantage of us. That's why we have to stand. And that's what he said to the Ephesians there. We put on the whole armor of God so that we can stand. And if we don't, We're setting ourselves up for a fall. He said, again, to the Corinthians, he said, not only should Satan get an advantage of us, he said, we're not ignorant of his devices. Well, I think sometimes we are. Are you ignorant of his devices? Let's first get a bit of a glimpse of his character. In Isaiah 14, in verse 12 to 14, the Bible said, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? Isn't that an interesting thing? Nothing more that he would love to do than weaken the nations. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Kind of lofty, don't you think? He's aspiring. He's not just saying, well, I hope that I can just keep my little job. And no, he's somewhat prideful. Job 41 and verse 34 says, he beholdeth all high things. He is the king over all the children of pride. Look with me in Exodus chapter 15. In Exodus chapter 15, I'll draw your attention to an incident here. And this takes place immediately after the plagues of Egypt. They're on top, right? They're coming out, they're singing, they're shouting the victory, kind of like us today. But it says, I'll just read from verse 1, "Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he is become my salvation. He is my God. I will be prepared, or I will prepare him an habitation, my father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his host hath he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Thy right hand, O Lord, is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, O Lord, hath dashed in pieces the enemy." There's that enemy again. "And in greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sendest forth thy wrath, which consumed them as stubble. And with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as an heap, and the depths were congealed in the heart of the sea." Well, that's giving God an awful lot of credit, isn't it? Boy, that's looking at that and saying, "You were there all the time, Lord. You fought mightily for us. I knew it wasn't going to be a vain thing for me to trust in you." Man, we can make that claim this morning. But look at the enemy here. Look at how the enemy had a plan. It says there, the enemy said, "I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied upon them. I will draw my sword. My hand shall destroy them." See, even though we see the end result and how the hand of the Lord was mighty, the enemy was still operating with a plan. And we see that plan laid out there. And I want to just kind of address it because, you know, if you think about the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, that's what he did. That's what the enemy, the devil, used on Eve in the garden, right? But it's also what he used in the wilderness with Jesus Christ. So let's take that period of time. For 4,000 years, he couldn't come up with a new plan? No, he didn't need to, because he was batting 1,000 with that one. All you got to do is go in that area. And he has a plan here. And the enemy has a plan. And whether it was through this process, and I'm not saying it's necessarily the devil that was orchestrating the stay-at-home order and all of that, but through the process, through this pandemic, I believe the devil has a plan in what he wants to, because he'll use anything. Any weapon at his disposal, he'll use that in order to get to us. What are those things? I'm glad you asked. The first thing that he said there in verse 9, he said, "I will pursue. I will pursue." Satan stalks. Satan stalks. He's a stalker. In 1 Peter 5 and verse 8, the Bible said, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking, stalking, searching." He's looking, folks. "Seeking whom he may devour." Not who he may disrupt their day. Devour. Satan stalks. It says there, "I will pursue." Have you ever watched one of those National Geographic things where they always show the plains of Serengeti? And they always, the lions come out and they have all of those little gip-gips and all those little things. They're just bouncing around, happy-go-lucky, like a lot of Christians, you know. They don't take this Christianity business seriously, just bouncing around. But they don't realize that there's a lion out there. And the lion's watching the whole crowd. You think he's going to go after the one that's got the whole armor of God on? Not in your life. You're going to say, oh, look at that. That one's waiting for me. But he's looking for the other ones. Oh, yeah. The lion finds the weak. He finds the defenseless. He finds the lone gazelle. That's what he pursues. He sneaks up on it. He's seeking it out around the whole. He's fixated on it. Is the devil fixated on you? Are you giving him cause to isolate you from the crowd? Say, oh, I can take that one out. When was the last time you saw an elephant being chased down by a lion? Oh, I suppose there's some daffy lions out there that would do it. They might gang up on it. Lesson to be learned there, too. You say, I'm not a little gazelle. I'm an elephant. Yeah, but if the devil gets a few more of his helpers, they can take out an elephant. Man, it's frightening when you watch these characters gang up on somebody. Again, Ephesians 6:11 says, put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. It's time to take a stand, folks. Time to realize we're in the last days. Man, if this isn't it, I don't know what to say. This thing seems to be all coming together, and it's kind of startling to see. You know, prophetic things, and you say, well, this doesn't apply here. Yeah, but Jesus talked about our ability to be able to see the times and the seasons. We may not know the day or the hour, but the seasons, there's no one in their right mind who go, boy, what are we in? This is a pretty warm winter we're in. No, they realize we're not in winter anymore. Hosea 8 and verse 3 said, Israel hath cut off or cast off that thing that is good. The enemy shall pursue him. Wow, isn't that something? Think about that, folks. If the devil, if Satan watch you cast off your armor, if he sees you cast off the church, if he sees you cast off Bible reading, if he sees you cast off prayer and all that stuff, he immediately goes, oh, look at that. Look at that. Job 2 and verse 2, the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it. Now, do you think he was just killing time? He's on a mission, folks. A mission to pursue. A mission to stalk. That's why Ephesians 5 and verse 15 and 16 instruct us, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. And we're in some evil time. Now, I think you understand this, I hope you understand this, that not all evil in the Bible means moral depravity. I mean, when we get in some evil times, times where things are just not good, this pandemic has been an evil, a blight in the world, in society. Matter of fact, it's one of the few things that has really overcast the entire globe. Most of the pandemics have been kind of somewhat localized in one country or another. This thing has spread over the whole world. You know how sometimes, is it the Democrats that do this? Because they're always notorious for, well, you can't let a catastrophe or something go to waste?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. I've heard that before. Well, do you think the devil is going to let a worldwide pandemic go to waste? he's going to say, this is the greatest thing that's ever happened for me. He's pursuing. The second thing I want you to see there is not only is he pursuing, he said, I will overtake. He's not saying, oh, I hope. Because he knows. He knows if we allow ourselves to be placed in a situation where we're not prepared, not only, all he's got to do is seek us out, and then he already knows, I can overtake that. I will overtake that. Satan surpasses. I know there's people out there that say silly things like, greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Whatever that means. That's true. That's true, but guess what? If you feed the flesh, your flesh is what's going to be strong, not your spirit. If you walk in the spirit, you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Contrarywise, if you do the opposite, you'll be a weakling, and you'll be pickings for the devil. How does a thief overtake you? Well, the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 4, but ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. A thief surprises you when you least expect it. Well, at least before they got as bold as home invasions today. I mean, they used to wait for you to leave. As a surprise. Matthew 24 and verse 43, but this know that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched. If every one of us knew that Jesus Christ was coming back today or tomorrow, boy, we'd be on guard. We'd be listening to every little sound. We'd be looking for signs and one. See, we're not thinking that way. And our guard is let down. Romans 12 and verse 3 says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. I'm okay. You're okay. We're okay. We're the Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Well, I like the name and it sounds pretty strong, but we could be cream puffs. Imagine standing before the Lord and giving an account for your life. And the Lord saying, you were the cream puff of the Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Wouldn't that be awful? 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 11 and 12 says, now all these things happened. Paul was discussing all the things that happened to those people in the Old Testament. All the things that they did, all the things that they allowed to take place in their lives. He said, all these things happened unto them for ensamples. And they are written for our admonition upon the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. We're not as tough as we think we are. We're not as solid as we think we are. We're not as spiritual as we think we are. Yeah. It's time to stand, folks. Time to stand. There'll be a lot of people in biblical Christianity that will use this pandemic as bye-bye. Oh yeah, count on it. Don't let it be one of you. It's time to take a stand. Why? Because in our text here in Exodus 15, the enemy said, he said this, I will pursue. He said, I will overtake. And then look at number 3. He said, I will divide. I will divide. Satan separates. Because he knows that, you know, it's a military strategy. Divide and conquer. It emanated from the devil himself. Jesus said to Simon Peter, wasn't he like the top dog at one time? Neither one that walked on water. Neither one that when they came to take Jesus, he immediately whomped off the ear of Malchus. Yeah. See, the more spiritual you get, the more of a target you have on your back from the enemy. Luke 22, verse 31, the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you so that he could have you over for lunch. No, that he may sift you as wheat. Man, he wants to put you through it. He wants to grind you down to powder. Sifting separates. Sifting divides. He wants to separate you from the church. He wants to separate you from the Bible. He wants to separate you from brothers and sisters in Christ. He wants to separate you from your family. See, and he could use this pandemic as a great opportunity to do it. John Newton's rule of life was, he said, I make it a rule of Christian duty never to go to a place where there is not room for my master as well as myself. 1 Timothy 5 and verse 15, for some are already turned aside after Satan. And the thing is, you probably wouldn't even know it to look on, because before, long before that ever happens, long before you end up in a far country, long before you're given over completely, you already made the decision here. Remember, it all began, we read the verses in Isaiah 14. The key element there on the part of the devil, our enemy here, he said that he said in his heart, I will. That's where it all begins. There's no indication that he ever audibly said it out loud. He didn't shake his fist in the face of God and say, yeah, well, wait and see. I'll take that throne of yours, buddy. No, he said it all in here. Divide and conquer. Ecclesiastes 4 in verse 9 and 10. Solomon has some wisdom, doesn't he? He said, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. He said, for if one fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he hath not another to help him up. Matthew 12 and verse 25, Jesus knew their thoughts. Talked about this again in Sunday school this morning. Every kingdom, he said, divided against itself is brought to desolation. And every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. You think the devil, the enemy, doesn't know? I got to divide and conquer. Yep. I will divide, he said. In Mark chapter 3, the scribes accused Jesus of being a devil. We looked at that this morning in the Sunday school hour. They accused him of being a devil. Let me give you the last one here. Again, all in verse number 9. He said, I will draw my sword. I will draw my sword. Gee, I wonder what he wants to do with that. Probably wants to show us his new sword. No. Remember, be sober, be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. It's on a mission, folks. 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 5, Paul said, to deliver such a one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, because he has the ability to do it. John 8 and verse 44, Jesus said, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father he will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. You think he had something to do with Cain killing Abel? Yeah, he did. Revelation 12 and verse 9, that great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. We live in a day and age right now where deception is going on. And I'm not privy to all of the information, but I know this, that I know I've got to be sober. I've got to be alert. I've got to walk circumspectly because I'm not going to be deceived. I don't want to be deceived. But I know that there's an enemy out there that wants to do that. So I got to stand. I got to say, we can't afford to, in the day in which we live, to just roll over. Let me close with this story. An old lion who was too weak to hunt or to fight for his food decided that he would get it by his wits. Remember, we talk about in Revelation 5, the lion of the tribe of Judah. But you know what? People oftentimes talk about the devil as a lion. He's not a lion. He's a He's a stray pussycat. We said, well, no, in 1 Peter 5, it says that he's an adversary and as a roaring lion. Yeah, but it didn't say he is a roaring lion. He's just got a loud mouth. He's not the lion of the tribe of Judah. So what's he wanting? He's wily, the wiles of the devil. So he realizes limitation. So you think he's going to get in your face and roar at you? No. You think he's going to grab a hold of you and try to rip you? No. An old lion who was too weak to hunt or fight for his food decided he must get it by his wits. He lay down in a cave pretending to be ill, and whenever any animals came by to visit, he seized them and ate them. When many had perished in this way, a fox, who had seen through the trick, came and stood at a distance from the cave and inquired how he was. "Bad," the lion answered, and asked why he didn't come a little closer. He said, "I would have come in," said the fox, "but I saw a lot of tracks going in, but none coming out." Don't take the enemy lightly, folks. It's time to stand. We're not ignorant of his devices. The strategies of the enemy here, he stalks, he'll surpass, he separates, he slays. It's time to take a stand.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.